way, this graph, better than any words I can use, describes why I am in real estate. That sums it up. If you don't understand anything I'm saying, just remember that graph. How is it possible that something growing at 6% has almost negligible growth, whereas something else growing at only 5% can beat the pants off it? Why is that? Leverage. That's right. It's because the 6% growth is on the 17,000 cash input. The 5% growth on the real estate is not on the $17,000 cash component. It's not even on the $99,000 purchase price component. It's on the $102,000 market value component. It's 5% of $132,000 in the first year alone. Now, before we go any further, ask yourself this question. Can you think of any other investment scenario where you can earn income, pay all your expenses, and then you end up with your net pre-tax income? You pay tax on it, and you end up with more than you did before you paid tax. Do you see what I'm saying? With any other business, if you earn $5,000 after all your expenses, you expect to pay tax on it, right? Well, here you've got a way where you earn income and you don't pay tax, you get money back. We're earning more after tax than we had before tax. The internal rate of return is still infinite. I now want to do one thing which I find very amusing. Let's compare putting no money in Tom's property versus putting no money in the bank at 6%. In fact, well, because it's so inequitable, let me make it 8% interest. So here we have no money in the bank at 8% interest versus no money in Tom's property growing at only 5%. I think Tom deserves a round of applause. Thank you, Tom. You know, there are a number of comments floating around saying, hey, this is Sydney. Where would you find a $99,000 property? Look, do we need to take you by the hand and lead you to it? Well, yes, you will say. Then you say, this sounds too good to be true. It must be a trick. These deals are real. If you think $99,000 is a good deal, I once bought a property in Queenstown. Who's been to Queenstown, just to show you? Look, quite a few. So you know how beautiful it is, right? It was in one of those realtor magazines with lots of color photos and a description. Here they had this little wooden two-bedroom cottage, and the caption read, help Jed shift. Offers over $20,000 considered. And my initial reaction was, this has to be a typographical error. But I made the call anyway, and I said, tell me about it. And the real estate agent said, well, the owner has absconded back to England, owing everyone money. They just want to recover some of their losses. I said, ah, interesting. Tell me, you asked for offers over $20,000. When you ask for offers over X dollars, does anyone ever offer you X plus $5,000 or X plus $10,000? And she thought about it, and she said, actually, no. I said, well, in that case, I'll make an offer of $20,000. Now, I did something which I want you to think very carefully about. What I did is I wrote out a check and stapled it to the contract. Right now, does this change the legality of the offer I was making? Not at all, right? It doesn't change it because if they accepted my offer and I hadn't written that check, would they have had to come to me and say, we need the deposit? Would I have had to pay that deposit? You bet. Conversely, if they don't accept my offer, can they bank the check? No. So it doesn't change the legality of it at all. However, by having a check stapled to the contract, it makes it a very seductive document. Now, does they think, if we can't assign, we can bank that check. It makes it very real. It lets them see that you are serious. So, always staple a check to the contract. I did this. Well, they sent it off to the bank. The bank was in a mortgagee position, you know, they'd taken over. And they wrote me a letter. I don't know if they recognized me as the property investor, but they said, Dolf, surely you realize that this property is worth a lot more than $20,000. Why don't you come back with a decent offer? And I thought about that for a moment, and I wrote them a letter. And I said, well, you say it's worth more than $20,000, but who are you to say so? You're a bank. You're not property investors. You fund other people. In fact, if you really understood it, you'd probably invest. But anyway, I didn't know that. I said, a real estate agent may be induced to suggest a high price to get a listing or a low price to make a sale. A valuer might suggest a slightly higher price to appease a seller or a slightly lower price to appease a buyer. There is only one price at which everyone can agree on that the property is worth that amount, and that is the one price at which a willing buyer and a willing seller meet. And if you think it's worth a lot more than $20,000, I suggest you find a buyer who agrees with you and sell it to them. In the meantime, to show you that I'm still a serious candidate, I will raise my offer to $22,000. Do you think they accepted it? No way. They wrote back and said, that's ridiculous. However, if you raise the offer to $22,500, it's yours. So what do you think they were doing by getting an extra $500? It's called saving face. They didn't want me to be able to say, well, I got that property for what I was willing to offer. They wanted to be able to say forevermore, De Roos tried to get that property at his price, but we forced him to come up to our price. Was it a problem for me? No. $22,000 and a half. I bought it sight unseen. I phoned my tradesman that I used down in Queensland. I said, hey, I've just bought this property. Check it out, will you? So he phoned back later on that day and said, well, I've had a look. It's not bad. The front door's shut. You have to replace that. And the shower cubicle, it's all of that sort of hardwood. It's all rotted away. You'll have to replace it. You should put a fiberglass shower cubicle in there. I said, all right, see to it. Well, as proof that he had integrity, he could have taken me for a ride. Instead, he phoned back 5 minutes later. He said, have you seen what's in the basement? I said, I didn't even know it had a basement. He said, there's a brand new front door there and a fiberglass shower cubicle. Amazing. About 3 weeks later, I went down to Queenstown. I was seeing my property manager down there. I said, hey, let's check out this new place. So he was showing me through it, and I said, you never told me you had a tenant in it already. He said, I don't. He said, well, to whom does all the stuff belong? He said, what stuff? I said, come on, the crockery, the cutlery, the microwave oven, the kitchen chairs, the table, the linen, the closets, the beds, the mattresses, everything. He said, oh, that'll came with the house. These deals exist, folks. It's been rented out ever since. I don't know what my return is. It's huge. But those deals exist. If you don't think $99,000 deals exist in the greater Sydney area, you won't find them. You won't even go looking for them. When someone gives you one on a silver platter, you say, oh, there's something wrong with that one. Do I ever phone for these seemingly incredible deals and I'm told by someone, what, are you an idiot or something? That's a typo. Of course it's not $20,000. Of course it's not $99,000. Do you think that happens? Of course it does. But about once in every 20 attempts like that, I find one that's just a steal. There are many, many deals out there. A lot of people are reluctant to borrow money. They think there's something wrong with getting money from a bank or from anyone else. There's not. There's nothing illegal or immoral about it. Banks make their money that way. They accept depositors' funds, pay them a measly interest rate, and then lend it out in the market at a higher rate. It's just a very legitimate way of doing business. But people get scared having a lot of debt. They get scared because we've been brought up to believe that debt is bad. Don't you dare buy anything until you've got the cash to pay for it. Who's been told that? Sure, lots of us, right? So we think, well, since real estate requires us to borrow a lot of money because I don't have any, then therefore I can't do it because borrowing is bad. Whereas Robert Kiyosaki says there's a difference between good debt and bad debt. Bad debt is debt on stereos and cars and things that go down in value the moment you buy them. Good debt is debt on assets that go up in value. In fact, I don't sleep well at night when I don't have enough debt. And the reason is as follows. When you owe the bank $5,000, you've got a problem. But when you owe the bank $5 million, they have a problem. And they do funny things. They phone you up and say things like, hey there, how would you like to go out to lunch this week? And you get all excited, you say, yes. But you're a smart cookie. You say, hang on a minute. We went out for lunch last week, and you guys shouted, I suppose you want me to. And you're about to finish the sentence, and they say, of course, it's on us, as usual. Why would the banks phone you and take you to lunch when you owe them $5 million? Because they want to give you more money. Why would they want to give you more money instead of someone that only has borrowed $100,000 or so? Good investment, good risk. Exactly. Because you always, how frequently? Always pay the interest on time. Why would you do that? So they give you more money. It's a vicious circle. They want confidence in you. When you buy your first property, they might think you're a hot-headed fool who's been to some seminar and you're just doing this on a whim. What will be the flavor next week? But when you've bought one, two, three, when you're on your 10th property, especially when you've got a few mortgages with that particular bank and you've got a history, a track record of always paying on time, they're going to think you're a great risk. They want to give you more money. We've got a whole section we can do on how to apply for a mortgage in such a manner that you're almost guaranteed to get it. And the way you do it, just very briefly, is you create a document. Instead of going to the bank, cap in hand, saying, please, would you consider me for a loan, maybe? You've got to turn it around. Most people think you get a loan from the bank. Doesn't that put you in a weak position? You're asking them for something. How would you like to offer them something? This is how it goes. You want to buy a piece of real estate, but don't have the money. And even if you have the money, you wouldn't use cash to buy it, right? Okay. The banks have all the money, and fortunately, don't want to buy it. So you go to the bank and say, hey, chums, you've got all this cash in the bank. I want to buy a property. I don't have the money, or I choose not to use it. Why don't we do a deal? You lend me the money to buy the property, and I will give you a pledge that I will faithfully pay interest every time it's due, and I will pay back principal on some prescribed basis. So they give you the money, you give them the pledge. That pledge is called a mortgage. All right, so all you need to do is convince them that you're a good risk. You go to them and offer them an investment. And in this proposal for finance that I can talk about in more detail when we have more time, the first sentence is, a mortgage of however much, $99,000, is offered on a property situated at, well, Tom didn't tell us where, but anyway, wherever it's situated. Did you hear what I just said? A mortgage is offered of so many dollars. We're offering the bank a mortgage. All we ask in return is the money. But can you see how psychologically, instead of going there cap in hand saying, please consider me for this loan, you are offering them something. In fact, if you're really smart, what you do is you'll create 20 or 30 copies of this document and you'll hawk it around all the banks. And you don't need to be surreptitious about it and say, oh, here's your copy and pretend you haven't got any others. I'm bold and upfront about it. Say, well, you've got copy number 13. I've already been to these banks. It's first up, best dressed, or whoever offers me the best terms, they're the ones I'll go with. And suddenly you'll find that the banks are vying for your business. In fact, banks want to lend you money. If you don't write anything else down tonight, I suggest you write that down. Banks want to lend you money. And then the follow-up sentence is, let them give it to you. Now, always at the end, there are always people who whinge and say, yes, but I don't have any cash, so I can't do it, because banks will only lend me 80% or 90%. Well, there's nothing to stop you traveling around. I remember in the 70s in the Netherlands, banks were offering 125% mortgages. They were offering you more than the purchase price. Was that legal? Of course it was. Everything with real estate, just about everything is legal. Now, why were they offering more money? They wanted to give you more money. Firstly, the banks were awash with money. They wanted to give you more money so that you could renovate it. And, you know, do up the kitchen or the bathroom or perhaps build an extra bedroom. The value of the property would have gone up because of those renovations, so the bank still has collateral to cover themselves. They just wanted to give you money. Well, in the States at the moment, you can get 120% finance. Not on every deal, but on many deals. So one thing I'll encourage you to do later on is look further afield than your own backyard. In fact, I would say this to you. If you guys have all of your investment eggs in one basket, the Australian basket, then maybe you should rethink that. The Australian market has been a small percentage of the total worldwide market. Do you want to have all your risk in one country? And it's not being seditious or trying to get you to be traitors to your own country. For heaven's sake, I encourage Americans to invest down here. There's probably more money coming in here than would ever go out. I would strongly encourage you to look at all your financing options. So one of the whinging questions I get is, where I come from, you won't get a 70 or 80% mortgage. Look around, shop around. And if they don't give it to you, does that stop you from buying it for zero down? Of course not, folks. How else could you buy real estate without putting any cash in yourself? Do you think it's possible? Of course it is. How would you do it? Use your equity in your own home. That's possible, isn't it? Let's say you've got a home here in Sydney, it's worth $500,000, you've got a $300,000 mortgage. Could you borrow another $50,000 against your own home to help buy an investment property? Of course you can. There's mortgage interest on your own home tax deductible. It's not great. But if you take out an extra $50,000 to buy an investment property, is the mortgage interest on that $50,000 tax deductible? Sure it is. So you win all round. So you can do all of these things. Not only that, but surprisingly simple. So you can use the equity in your own home. What else could you do to buy a property without using any of your own money? An IOU. From whom? Vendor. Exactly. Ask the seller, are you willing to leave him $60,000? Do you think they're going to laugh at you? Some will. But think of it this way. You've got an elderly couple. They've raised five kids. They've got a six-bedroom home. It's too much for them to manage. It's gone up in value enormously. It's now worth $1.2 million. They are downsizing to buy a nice little apartment worth only $800,000. That leaves $400,000 cash left over. What are they going to do with that money? So you come along and say, all right, well, I'll buy your property. However, I'd like you to leave $300,000 in, and I'm willing to pay 6% interest for however many years, 5 years. They're comparing that with the measly amount of money they get by having it in the bank. They're likely to say to you, $300,000, are you sure you don't want $400,000? Some people relish the thought of still having some ownership of the property they've lived in for 40 years. So ask. If you don't ask, you'll never find out. If you find a deal tomorrow, it's on the market at $1 million, it's worth $3 million. You don't have $1 million. Could you buy it? What would you do to buy it? Well, you could try the banks. What if the bank said no? What would you do? Yes, sir. Get some money from a friend. Do you think you'd find friends who'd be willing to go house with you on a deal? You put up the money, you get half the profit. There's $2 million profit in it. Is that possible? Of course, again, you're limited by your imagination. And the thing is, I don't want you to just sit there and say, oh, that might work, well, that's possible. Start dreaming up your own ideas. Run an ad in the paper. Terrific deal found, wanted, equity partner. You might get 20 phone calls, of which three are real contenders to be a partner because they've got the money. Do you think there are people out there with a lot of money who don't have any business sense as to what to do with it? Of course there are. Again, if you have a track record of looking after them really well, in other words, don't be too mean, don't try and get it all for yourself. If you make great investments for them, not only are they likely to invest more money with you, they'll refer their friends to you. It's just common sense. Have you ever seen billboards, advertisements on radio, television saying, hey, do you want to buy antiques or gold or platinum or baseball cards or maybe fancy furniture? Do you want to invest in all these sorts of things? We will lend you the money to do it. Doesn't happen, does it? But all over the world, banks will lend you money to buy real estate. That tells you two crucial things about real estate. Firstly, it's a very safe and secure investment. And secondly, and most importantly, we come to this point again and again, you don't even need the money to buy it. I can't emphasize that point enough. You are a deal maker. You put things together on paper, and you find a way of making it work. How can you make deals work? I came across a funeral parlor. Now, a funeral parlor doesn't sound very interesting. In fact, if I tell you that a funeral parlor is a viewing room and a slumber room and a chilling room, no marks for guessing what they keep cold in there, folks. And a mortuary with channels in the ground to let the fluids flow out. Right? It was empty. It had been empty for 3 or 4 years. What would you do with a funeral parlor? Turn it into a restaurant? So what I did is I got someone to phone every funeral director in the country and say, hey, how would you like to move into the city? And most of them said, you've got to be kidding, and hung up. Said, nothing, hung up. But one of them said, you know what, I've always wanted to move into that city. What's the deal? I said, well, there's this building available, why don't you go and buy it? And why would I offer that, by the way? I didn't want a tenant who begrudged the fact that I'd beat him to this property. He said, no, I'm a funeral director. I don't want to be my own landlord. I'd want someone else to own it. I said, right, we can do a deal. He said, how about we sign up a heads of agreement whereby, subject to me buying it, you agree to become my tenant at this amount per year and all that sort of thing. He said, hang on a minute, sonny, you're not so fast now. He said, I'll only do it if you give me a long-term lease. I said, how long do you want? He said, I'd only consider it if you give me 10 years, plus a right of renewal for another 10 years. I said, you know what? We can talk. We can do business. So I signed him up on this heads of agreement. I went back to the sellers. The property had gone up for auction, and it failed to reach the reserve price of $100,000.